Thank you. Hey, good evening, everyone. Welcome to service tonight. Before we get started tonight, I want to ask all of you, if you would you mind moving up on the front two rows here? We're going to do something kind of special, kind of intimate here this evening, and y'all come on up here, and I would love for a few of y'all to fill these empty seats up here. Some of you that I promise we're going to do everything you know tonight is some songs that you know. So come on up here. Some of you guys come on up here and help us sing tonight. All right, we're going to get started. I've got one more empty chair up here. Who's the lucky person that's going to fill it? I'm waiting on volunteers, or I'll fill it for you. All right. All right. We got one more person. Who's the lucky person that's going to fill it? For those of you that are watching, we're going to get started momentarily, so y'all hang tight. You're joining us tonight here at Union Baptist Church. I know we've got some folks watching from different places. I've already got the calls this afternoon, so y'all come on. Let's see, one more person, real quickly, one more person. All right, I tell you what, we got one more person. All right, but if you'll look under your seat, you'll find a book. And what I'd like for each one of you guys, and ladies and gentlemen, which all, if you would grab your hymnal tonight, for those of you that are joining us, welcome to our Sunday evening service. Tonight is a very special night. We're doing hymn songs and testimonies, and trust that you are going to be blessed here tonight. And it is good to see all of you. I hope all of you have had a really, really good day. First thing I want to do, turn over to hymn number 772. We're going to do When We All Get to Heaven. Still waiting on one more chair. Anybody that'll help us fill one more chair, real quickly. All right, Glenn, come on. Thank you very much, Glenn. Come on up here. All right. We are going to sing. It's very laid back. I'm not going to make you stand tonight. I'm going to let you sit. It's going to be very relaxed. But you know what? Most of all, I hope and pray that you'll just open up your heart and let the Spirit touch you, because we have some very special testimonies here tonight that I know will bless your heart. So let's sing first, second, and let's do all three verses of When We All Get to Heaven, all right?
Sing the wild Christ love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansion, proud and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing!
sing the second verse.
While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we walk into heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Sing the last now.
Onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. When we all think we heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we
sing the chorus again. Yes, when we
all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Now let's sing there. We have come into this house to worship him, and then we'll sing Sweet, Sweet Spirit. That is going to be page 224 and then hymn number 391. 224 and 391.
We have come into this house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into this house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into this house and gathered in his name.
Let's forget about ourselves now.
Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves and magnify.
Sing Sweet, Sweet Spirit now. 391.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And I know that it's the spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face,
Dear Lord, we come to you right now. We're so thankful, Lord, that you've given us another day just to come, just to relax and be among church family, be among our brothers and sisters. Lord, you said in your word, all that we have to do is trust and believe. And Lord, that you would just give us the desires of our heart. And Lord, we're asking right now, Lord, that your spirit would abide in this place. Lord, as we sing these songs, as we share testimonies, Lord, for the ones that are here, for the ones that will hear this tonight in different places, for the ones that maybe will see this in the weeks and months and years to come, Lord, I pray that you would just use this very special service, Lord, for your honor and your glory. It's so good to be able to come and worship you tonight, and we are thankful for that. Lord, just walk the aisles of this place, touch your hearts, and help us to be found faithful. And we ask these things in your name. Amen. Hope and pray that you've come to have a good time here tonight. And my goodness, it is good to see everybody. Tonight, again, is just a very special hymn sing testimony service. And this is a time that each one of you can sing or share a testimony that would uplift and glorify God. I've asked a few people to kind of start us off tonight. And I want to ask Ms. Cherie Cunningham, would you come up here and just kind of share about how God has worked in your life? And I want you to listen to as Cherie shares what's on her heart tonight.
Something I wanted to say. I was raised at Bear Creek. Oh, and I'll cry, so get ready for that. I was raised at Bear Creek Church, and my daddy was a deacon there. So, of course, we were there every time the doors were open. For one exception, I did not have to go if it was deacon's meeting. But other times, I was always expected to be there. And I always had a good time. Had lots of friends there. But, they say I cut my teeth on the back pew. So that's how much we were there, from the little bitty all the way up. I fell under conviction when I was 11. And it was really bothering me. You know, we didn't have children's church back then. We didn't take the kids out to another room. All the kids stayed in the service from the time they were little bitty all the way up, unless you got carried out because you were misbehaving. My daddy just had to thump me on the head, and I knew better. So, but when I fell under conviction, I got so bothered by it that I could not sleep, I couldn't eat, I had nightmares. I was just tore up all the time because I knew that if I died, I'd go to hell. I knew I was a sinner, that I had done things wrong, that I hadn't always done what Mom or Daddy asked me to do, and that sometimes I had lied, and I knew that that was wrong not to honor your parents. So, Mama noticed that I was so bothered by something, and she didn't know what it was. And she asked me one night, "Cherie, what is wrong with you?" And I just told her. And she said, "Well, you don't have to worry about that anymore. We can fix that." And she went and got Daddy. Daddy come in there and talked to me. And that night is forever etched in my mind and in my heart. Because I can remember that our living room, furniture, the Smothers Brothers was on TV. It's just forever in my mind. But I talked to Daddy about it and told him the problem. And he went down the Roman road with me with scripture, and he asked me a lot of questions, and he said, "Well, do you want to pray about it? Do you want to pray and ask God to come into your heart and ask him to forgive you?" And I said, "I do." So he, you know, kind of coached me about the prayer and what I was going to have to, you know, ask for, and that I needed to confess to him and tell him what I'd done wrong, and that I was going to have to you know, be a Christian and be better, and that I was expected to live better. So I did that, and immediately I felt so much better. I went to bed that night and slept. The first time I had really slept in a long time, you know, without being bothered. I was changed, and I never, ever questioned it. I knew that I was Christian, and I knew I had to tell others, and I try to tell others. I'm not as good of a witnesser as I should be, but I try to live to show people that they need to be a Christian too, and to invite them to church and invite them to know the God I know. Now, I can see this piece of paper to see what else I was going to say. When I got saved was in February, and Bear Creek didn't have a baptistry. So we had to wait until May, until it warmed up some, for me to be baptized. And I got baptized in Mr. Rex Wilson's muddy pond out by his house. But it didn't matter. I was glad to be baptized. And but I know after I was saved at home, you know, Daddy told me, he said, now, if you follow this up, we're joining the church and getting baptized. So the next Sunday, I wanted to go forward, but I've always been a little shy to go up in front of crowds like this. And but I wanted to, so I prayed that God would give me the courage to step out and go up. And I remember the first step, but I never remember the rest of them. Because I just remember that first step, and then I remember shaking the preacher's hand, joining the church, and then waiting and waiting and waiting to get baptized. But I guess, you know, as the years went on and I grew up, got married, and then just working local, I went through a divorce and found myself a single parent this week, and making $4 an hour. And I figured then I need to go take some night classes so I can get a better job, so I can make more money. So I went to, one day I went to Jackson State and I went to Lambeth, and I asked them about taking some night courses, and they all just handed me a course catalog and said, thanks for stopping by. And so I took that and put it in the car, and I thought, well, I'll go to Union since I'm in Jackson and I'll hit all of them. So I went there, and when I told the girl at the desk what I wanted, she said, hold on just a minute. And immediately she came back with one of the guidance counselors and little lady Elizabeth Wingo, and she looked to be about 95, but she was a Spitfire. And she said, you come right back here. She took me to her office. She started asking me all kinds of questions. What do you want to take? What are you interested in? And I said, well, I don't really know. I just want to, you know, look. I thought maybe something about drawing blood or something like that to work in the hospital. And she said, have you ever thought about being a nurse? And I said, well, I would like to, but I don't know if that would take a long time. I said, what nights do y'all offer those courses? And she said, well, we don't have night classes for nursing if they're during the day. And I said, well, I can't do that because I'm a single mother and I have a little girl that, you know, I couldn't be down here. I've got to work. And she said, well, we'll just work on it. You just wait. And she asked me why I was wanting to take them. And I said, I need, you know, a better job. And she said, well, how much did you make last year? And I told her how much I made an hour and how much my income was. So then she started pulling more papers. And she said, fill this out and fill this out. I think we can get you some financial aid. And I said, do you think I qualify? And she said, honey, you're living below the poverty line. Well, I just thought, oh my goodness, I thought I was doing okay. I knew I needed extra money, but I didn't know I was in that bad shape. But She gave me all the papers, and she said, you take these home, and you fill these out, and you get them back to me, and we'll see what we can do. And I said, okay, I'm just carrying all this stuff. And she said, you just remember, Romans 8:28 is still in the book. Mm-hmm. And I'd been to church all my life, but I didn't know what that verse was. So I had to go home and look it up. And that's been my favorite verse ever since. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, who are called according to his purpose. Mm-hmm. And that verse has got me through so much in my life, because I know if it appears bad to me, he can still work it out. Mm-hmm. He can still make things come out. The end can still be okay. And everybody that knows me has probably heard that's my favorite verse. Leslie knew it was my favorite verse. She got me a big wooden sign for my house, and it's got that on there. And like I said, that verse has got me through a lot. My mama had cancer when I was 17. I had to check out from school to take her for radiation treatments for 6 weeks. But she survived that and overcame it. But then she died when I was 53. And my daddy died with cancer the day after I turned 40. And, but I'm blessed. I've had lots of blessings in my life. My daughter, my grandson, coming to church here now is a big blessing. Her singing in the choir, because I can't sing, but she can. And you know, having my husband come to church with me all the time. If I get up with a bad headache or something, he gets up and comes on to church. Mm-hmm. It's important to be in church, and I'm glad we all are, but God can work through anything and turn it good.
Miss Elizabeth Wingo, had not heard that name in a long time. She changed my life as well. She's a wonderful lady. Wonderful lady. Amen. Amen. Thank you for sharing, Sheree. God is faithful. Amen. Amen. Brother Adam, why don't you come share? Yeah. I tell you what, let's sing a song. I'm gonna give you a break. Let's sing a song. Let's sing this song. Get a little country flavor. Let's sing "What a Friend We Have in Jesus," hymn number 630. Turn over in your hymn book. Let's sing the first and last verse.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
Last now.
Are we real? Savior is still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Brother Adam, come share, and if you would. Brother Adam and I, we've been in a discipleship group for about a year. I learned a whole lot about Adam. Adam learned a whole lot about me, but I'm glad to call you brother, glad to call you friend. Amen.
You too. I feel like I've shared my story with a lot of the people that's here tonight, so I'm sorry that you had to hear it again. But maybe I might remember some detail I didn't last time. So if any of y'all knew me when I was little, I grew up in church, going to church every Sunday. And I also was, my dad was in a gospel quartet, so I would also go along with that. And as you, a lot of people would think, I was the kid that never got into, well, I got in trouble, but I was the Christian kid that usually on the weekends was involved in church and going on the road with a Christian quartet, so it kind of kept me out of trouble. All the way up through when I was 15, I was at my friend's at Trinity Church in Decaturville, and I was there at the point where I was at the Heaven's Gates, Hell's Flames, and I made the decision that I wanted to be saved. And I think I can relate to that with a lot of kids. You're presented with a decision that says you need to be saved or you're going to hell. I mean, it's your point at that, you know, obviously nobody wants to go to hell, right? So we make the decision in our mind, well, I'm going to choose Jesus because I believed in Jesus and I no doubt that he was my Savior. But I made that decision there. The issue after that was, after I made that decision, I was not discipled, and I did not, I guess, through, even though I was a Christian, and I still believe that was my choice then, I made the choice then, but I did not go through discipleship. I did not really dig my roots down into being the Christian that I chose, that, the decision I made. So then, later on after that, something happened in my life that I got really mad at. It involved a girl, but I kind of rebelled against God, and I chose to do whatever I'd never done before, being in the church all weekend. And I was under conviction the entire time, but kind of like a dog that's getting beat, he's go back, you know, I got used to being under convictions all the time, where it was like the alarm going off, and I just kind of got numb to it. I felt the calling to get back in church many times, but I'd already made these decisions that everybody knew about, and I was like, well, they never will accept me back in doing things in church because of the life that I'm living right now. Well, when I started dating Brittany, I came here a few times, and I felt that call to help do something here, but I still had that excuse. And slowly, God took away all those excuses. And you can, if you want, I don't want to spend all night tonight talking about that. If you want to talk to me privately, I talk your head off. But I remember plain as can be, I was sitting over there, and Brother Chris said that we was going to start in men's Bible time a disciple group called the Master Life. And I heard God speaking to me. He said, I took away all your excuses. I took away you playing secular music. That didn't work out. I thought I was going to be a professional musician my entire life, and it never worked out. And I can see now that was God. Adam was trying to be selfish, and God wasn't going to allow me to do that because I chose him. So then I just decided right then that I needed to let God be my Lord. Not only my Savior that I chose back when I was a teenager, but God needed to be my Lord too, which meant that I obeyed him. And without obeying him, he cannot give me the blessings that I need to have. Brother Casey said it is a license of sin. Well, I was kind of using it as a fire insurance. I remember joking with my friends that back when we were out doing that stuff, and, you know, I'm saved. I'm still going to heaven. God might give me heck when I get there, but I'm still going to heaven, which is kind of a bad thing to say, but that's the fire insurance that I believe my salvation was. So at the point where I really, and I want to show that to everybody that I'm a discipleship group, you really got to turn over and let God be the Lord of your life, not only be the Savior. It comes hand in hand. And if you let him be the Lord, he can show you blessings that you never could imagine, and maybe in ways that you never thought of. But he knows what's best for you, and he can show you these things that you may not have thought was important back when you was living selfishly. But now that I have the blessings of my family, I have a son and daughter that is healthy, and a loving wife at home, and that support me in almost everything that I choose to do. I couldn't. I've seen other people with hardships. I just know that I'm blessed to have what I do have. And I'm extremely thankful for that. Thank you. Oh, the other thing I was going to say, she said Romans 8:28. I actually wear that on my wrist. Now, depending on what I'm studying at the time, sometimes I change the Bible verse on my wrist, but I just thought it was interesting. Then I had Romans 8:28 on my wrist while you said that. So.
Tell you what, Adam brings so much life, so much joy. We have a lot of good times, and I want to change gears right now. Let's do kind of a medley of some songs. This is some since it's a hymn sing. Let's do kind of a little old fashioned sing. Let's do "I Fly Away." Let's do "When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder" and "The Glory Land Way" in the key of G. Y'all do a little picking. Y'all do a little clapping. I'll do a little grinning, and we'll get through this song. All right. The first song, "I Fly Away," hymn number 779. The second one is hymn number 774. And the last one is, y'all will just have to look at me for the words because it's not in your book, all right? So 779 and 774. We'll start off with "I Fly Away" and then go into "When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder" and "The Glory Land Way." Can you clap along? Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Let's sing the last verse of that song. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joys will never end. I'll fly away. Take it a little bit. Flip over to hymn number 774. Let's sing the first and last verse. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, with the Savior first shall gather cooper on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the call up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder.
Sing with me now.
I'm in the way, the bright
shining way. I'm in the glory land way, telling the world that Jesus saves today. I'm in the glory land way. Yes, I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Telling you nearer and the way grow a clear for. I'll sing that chorus one more time. Yes, I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way. Glory land way, hanging out. Yes, now heaven is near, and the way groweth therefore. I'm in the glory land way.
Amen. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's good singing. I'm so thankful for people that are always sharing an encouraging word, and it never fails. I'll go out sometimes, and then I'll come back in a service, and I always meet someone, and he always shares an encouraging word about the service, and that's Brother Jerry Hunter. Brother Jerry, I want you to come and share how God has touched you and share your testimony for these folks. That's all right.
Raised in Indiana, and I went to school to church every day or every Sunday. Maple Christian Church is what it's called. We had a great youth group and did all kinds of youth activities. Churches interacted, had contests and things like that. And when I was 13, there was about 12 of us that day, I think, came up to accept the Lord. And Lowell Bain, the minister, had us turn around to the congregation and tell us who we thought Jesus Christ was. I believe Jesus is the living Son of God. And that goes along with Matthew 10:32, where he says, whoever shall confess me before men, him will I confess before my Father who is in heaven. Which made me feel that when I said that, Jesus turned around to God to confess me. And when I was 17, I was either going to go to Johnson Bible College and be a preacher, because I loved learning scriptures, memorizing them and everything, or I was going to go in the Marine Corps. Well, God didn't need another preacher, I guess, because I went in the Marine Corps. So at that time, anyway. And so I was in there for 4 years during the Vietnam era. Fortunately, I did not have to go to Vietnam. I worked with lawyers on court-martial cases. I went to the Naval Justice School in Newport, Rhode Island, and that's where I went. From then, I moved to California. After I got out, I met my wife. She was 14 years older than me, four kids. And everybody said, that'll never work. That's a fling. 42 years of marriage. And God was with us during the marriage. We didn't go to church every Sunday out in California. You basically got your TV preachers, and you just watch them, you know, and the Joel Osteens or the whoever, you know, and go along with that. But there was a time when I was working for a company, Frito-Lay, and I went into management because they changed the pay system. And next thing I know, it's management headcount reduction program. Bye-bye, see you later, 10 years don't mean nothing. You're looking at a $2,000 a month house payment. Who's going to make that? Where are you going to get this at? And God held us through, got us through that. And we just bought that brand new house. And then I went to work for a company called Hostess Skate Company. And 22 years into the company, they had reorganization. They merged the bread guys and the cake guys. But 22 years wasn't enough time for me in the company to keep my ride. I got bumped off for a year and a half. And I look back and I wonder how God helped us through that, but we did. We didn't lose anything. Eventually, we went back to work company for another 3 or 4 years. Well, then they went bankrupt. I get a call, I'm serving in a store. Oh, we're bankrupt. To bring the trucks back. I'm like, what in the heck is going on? But God was already at work behind the scenes. A friend of mine, at that time, Nature's Own Bread was just moving to California, and they were putting on routes. And for $2,000, you could get a route that would finance the rest and your own business, basically. And the man in charge of the whole area, I'd known for years. And when he heard it, he gave me a call. He goes, don't worry. Come, a guy named Torch says, come work for me Monday morning. I'll pay you $600 a week to run the route. And then when the new routes come on, you're guaranteed. You're going to have a route. You will be able to buy your own route. So that's where all my working experience and stuff came. And my wife was the love of my life. I woke up every day thanking God for her. And the one thing I would say, I remember she was, every day I would ask her, have I told you I loved you yet today? And she would say no. And I'd say, I love you. And she'd go, I love you more. And I'd give her a kiss. And we'd say this 3 or 4 times a day. I can understand what God says when you get married, you're like one. I mean, I didn't go play cards. I didn't go running around. I didn't, you know, go drink beers with the guys. I came home to my wife. We enjoyed each other so much. And the love was so strong. I know that other than God, my wife loved me more than anybody I have ever met. We decided to sell and move and retire to Tennessee here. And unfortunately, because of some health problems she had had, 4 months after we moved here, she passed away in my arms in the hospital. And I remember holding her, and I could see the monitor going out, and I told her, if you've got to go, you've got to go. But it did stir an anger in me against God that was hell-bent. I was so angry. I prayed to God to die, that if, you know, if you've taken her away, my only reason I'm even here, I love getting up and taking care of her for you. You know, you gave her to me. Why can't you give us another 10 years, you know, to enjoy the retirement, this and this? I was so angry with God for a long time. It was like 2 years before I ever come to the church. And God actually selected the church. And how he did that, a couple of times people came to the house, I don't remember who they were now, gave us the little homecoming package with ink pens in, is this. I just tossed them off the side, there was a couple extra ink pens. But I'm driving around, and since the church I came from said, don't make it a Christian church, I thought, what church do you go to? And Daisy and Robert had told me about this church, but I drove to a lot of churches. I drove in one day, and Anthony was here, and I talked to Anthony. So I said, okay, I'll come Sunday. And I came a couple Sundays, and I skipped a couple Sundays. And I was having a real bad day psychologically because missing my wife and stuff, and still angry with God for it. And I came in to talk to Anthony, and they were working on the video thing. And he talked to me and stuff, and he goes, I missed you last Sunday. Well, what do you mean? You know, I'm not a member of the church again the week before. And I go, what's going on here? You know, I mean, and so I started coming more, and I remember Robert, or I was standing in the pew there during altar call, and I thought, well, join the church. And he's like, oh, that's okay. Next week, join the church. I actually feel like the Holy Spirit knocked me out of my seat that day, and Anthony was standing right here saying, come on, you know. And so I came and I joined the church. And then Robert Mullins came and was preaching. And I remember that the first time I came to an altar call, I came up and talked to Robert. And he prayed with me. And he told me that it's not time for you to go yet. Quit praying to die. God's got something for you to do here at the church. He's got things for you to do, you know, and everything. And so when I started to walk away, he goes, and God wants you to know, he knows, he understands your anger. That helped, I guess, calm me down some, you know, a little bit. And I remembered when he brought the painting up, I had a feeling inside of me I was going to get that painting no matter what. That was going to be my painting. And it, when it turned out that way, I remember Robert walking past it. It's a God thing, I'm telling you. It's a God thing. But the one thing that the last couple months that God has laid on my heart, I guess Holy Spirit, is it to say something. And I keep saying, well, tell Anthony to say it. Tell Brother John to say it. You know, I'm nobody, you know. I don't want to say nothing, you know. I'm new, you know. I don't know everybody here. And a thought came across my mind today who said, Moses was a murderer. King David was an adulterer. Paul persecuted Jews. You're in good company. Look what they did when I told them to do something. Look what they did for me. So the one thing that it seemed like he wants me to mention is the altar call. And I know it's hard to get out of the seat and come up, because I put it off and put it off. But one Sunday, I watched Pastor Anthony give a great sermon. He kneeled at the altar. Nobody came up. 2 or 3 Sundays in a row, it was like that. And I shed a tear, and something told me, hey, why don't you go up? God's up there calling you. He says, where 2 or more people are gathered together in my name, I am there also. So every Sunday, God is here. And if you're here, God called you here. You know, God said, okay, I want you to come to church this morning. Mm-hmm. Some people said, oh, I'm going to go to Walmart instead. I'm going to go golfing. I'm going to go fishing. But you came here. The journey's halfway there, and God is standing right here. He's telling me, say, you know, tell him, I just want to talk to you. And if nothing else, if it's just to come up in a gratitude, attitude of gratitude, mm-hmm. and say, Lord, my life was perfect this week. I thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Greg said something this morning. Well, he said one last week about what does Union Church mean to you? Well, it's a family. I've had people call me if I don't show up and say, where are you at? I'm like, Gwen called, texted me, and I thought, I haven't even talked to Gwen. She texted me asking me where I'm at. And but it's a family of love here and stuff. And I made a commitment to myself that I will never watch my pastor or John. I love the way both the guys preach because it's so down to earth you can understand anything. If you don't understand something, they'll tell you. They'll mm-hmm. explain it to you. And I just made a commitment to myself. I know a lot of preachers don't preach on a spiritual war that's going on with Satan and God every day. He's trying to get your souls, and God is saying you can't have it, you know. And the commitment I made in my mind was that every time there's an altar call, I can tell you, you're going to see me right here. And the reason being, I'm not going to have Satan go back and say, get a report. Hey, we won one at Union Baptist today. The preacher preached a great sermon. God was there and nobody went to talk to him. And I just felt so sad. You know, and I'm thinking, the Lord's calling me. He's right here talking to me. And sometimes I will come up thinking I'm going to talk to God about something, and he's going to be talking about something else when I'm here. But when I turn around to go back, I know I hear his voice saying, Jerry, I will never leave you or forsake you. I will be with you to the end of the earth. And so the journey continues. Who knows what else God's got for me to do. But I remember one time I'll mention I didn't want to get out of the back. And God had Tam Doss get up, come all the way over there, and now what's it? He goes, God told me to pray with you. Mm-hmm. He prayed. And I've had Marty and Dan step and say, hey, if you want to go up there and pray, you want somebody to go with you, just nudge me, touch me, I will come up here. You've got a great set of deacons, people who helped you. Ricky Dirtyberry came up with me this morning. And then I was unbalanced and I fell back. And he goes, are you okay? And I said, well, is God knocking me down, telling me I better come here tonight and give this instead, instead of being out there? So,
amen. God's good, boy. You can be from California and still make it to heaven right there. Amen. Thank you so much, Brother Jerry. Awesome testimony. God is good. That's Dana. Dana, why don't you come up and share what God's laid on your heart? That's all right. You use the microphone.
So if I walk over here, yeah, this will still work because I have to look at all of you. So I'm going to try to make this on the shorter side, but my testimony is basically my life story. I was one of the lucky ones. I've always known church. I was raised in a little country Methodist church, Liberty Methodist Church in Sardis. My dad was a raging alcoholic, but when he was on the wagon, he was a beautiful soul who had a beautiful voice and was a great musician, and we would travel around to different churches for revival. So I was never raised to really think one church and one denomination was the way. You know, raised Methodist, but it was a country church, and now that I'm out of the church, I realize we didn't do a lot of the things the way the Methodists really believe. But anyway, it was a small church, and so on any given Sunday, if it was a good Sunday, we probably had 30 people there. On a bad Sunday, maybe 15. And so I was one of the few children my age, and so everybody in the church just poured into me. I had an amazing Sunday school teacher, Geneva Montgomery, and you'll hear me mention her later on in this. But I grew up with a bunch of adults in church, and we didn't see a whole lot of salvations or even people joining the church. And so that will kind of contribute to part of my story on down the line. But because we were so small, we didn't have VBS. We didn't even have Sunday night service, okay? Great little church, but we were small. We were country. And so in the summers, I loved VBS. And I would go to all the nearby churches for their VBS. And going into third grade at Scottsdale Baptist Church, I thought I knew the drill. We did the songs, we pledged the Bible, we pledged to the Christian flag, and they were supposed to dismiss us the last night of VBS, but the youth pastor said, if you're going into third grade or above, I want you to stay out in the sanctuary. And that night, he presented the gospel. And I had heard that story so many times, but for the first time in my life, it was real. It was real. And I sat there in on the very edge of the pew that I was sitting in, and my heart was beating, and I was hot, and I mean, I was just overcome with conviction that, you know, I helped put Jesus on that cross, and I was shaking, and I really didn't know what to do. And he said, if anybody has any other questions, just stay out here, but the rest of you can go back to class. And I went back to class. I don't know how I got through the night, but I went back to class. And I spent the next 3 years fighting conviction, very much like you. What now is an amazing feeling, amazing reminder that Jesus lives in me. At that time, in the early days of that, I started trying to read the Bible. I prayed endless prayers at night, probably till I fell asleep, because I was so convicted. And I was reading in a King James Bible, and I wasn't understanding everything. And why I did not talk to my mama or my daddy or my grandmother, who was like the epitome of a Christian little lady, I do not know. Didn't talk to my Sunday school teacher. I kept it all inside. And I thought I was doing a really good job of hiding it. But eventually, the conviction got so bad that I started making excuses why I didn't want to go to church on Sunday morning. I was sick or I was tired. I was trying to run from it. But apparently, my Sunday school teacher probably knew what was going on, Miss Geneva. And so she started telling me, you know, we would go over it every Sunday, and I never would say a thing. Yes, Miss Geneva. And because our church was so small, now I'm 8 years older than my little brother, and, well, Danny's not here, but my little brother was a mess. He was a mess. And so we didn't have a nursery or anything like that, and so the preacher was preaching, and I was on the very back pew, so I guess I was a back row Methodist, and I was back there by myself because my mother was, I don't know, either out beating him or trying to tend to him or something, but I was back there by myself. And the whole sermon, I was just sitting there like, you know, just stay in the pew, just stay in the pew. And but I knew what I had to do. And they played the invitation, and I sat there, and tears were falling. And Miss Geneva gets up from this side of the church and walks over back there to me, and she says, Dana, and that's all it took. And I walked up to the aisle, just like, I don't know who said it, that one step is all I remember was to get out, and then the rest. And it was a weight of 3 years come off my shoulders in that moment. You know, and I know you all know that feeling when the Holy Spirit fills your soul, and you know that you are good. You are white as snow. You belong to Jesus. The Holy Spirit's in you, and you have eternal life forever. And so we followed, because we didn't have a baptistry, we followed it up with baptism at a church, at the Methodist Church in Sardis. And that was my sixth grade year. So I carried that for 3 years. And like Adam, I really wasn't discipled well. In that little church, I was taught a whole lot about faith and how good God is to us. I definitely knew I could go to him with anything, and I didn't carry a whole lot of worry in my life for that reason. But I wasn't going out and reaching other people, and I also wasn't serving very much either. But that relationship kept me out of a whole lot of trouble in high school. Now, I still got into some stuff. Should I tell the story? All right. So, one thing I did, and this is like, you know, children, please ignore what I'm fixing to say, but this is like God really smacking you in the head. I guess I was, and Clay and I were together at the time. We started dating when I was in ninth grade. He was a senior. And I think I was probably 16, 17 when this happened. And I guess we were mad at each other because we were always together. But I was with my best friend, Julie, at the time. And Julie had started working at Sonic and kind of gotten in with a rough group, and she had started smoking. And I had no desire to smoke. My dad smoked, you know, but anyway. So if you have ever driven on 22 from Savannah to 22-100 Crossing, you may know where this story's going. But anyway, it was night, and she was going to smoke a cigarette. And I was like, you know, I mean, I have no desire for this, but, I mean, come on, tell me how to do it. She's like, okay, so you are going to take and light it, and you're going to suck in, and then you're going to swallow it. Now, I've later found out that that is not how you smoke, but that is how I did it. So I lit the cigarette, I sucked in, I swallowed it, and woo, was I on fire. And I hate Dr. Pepper, and the only thing that girl had to drink was Dr. Pepper. So I'm guzzling this Dr. Pepper, trying to, you know, cool my throat so I'm not going to die. And in the distance is this glowing cross. And it's getting closer and closer. And I grabbed Julie by the leg and I said, do you see that? And she said, yes. And I was like, oh, I didn't think this was gonna be like this. Is Jesus coming back? I was picturing him, not the cross. And then we finally get up there and I'm like, should we stop? And should we keep driving? Finally, we realize it, you know, it's just a giant glowing cross that's on the side of the road. But if that's not God hitting you in the head saying, you know, get it together, girl. But, and unfortunately, throughout my life, I have been stubborn, and it has taken a lot of hits in the head to get it together. So, fast forward, Clay and I get married. He's the love of my life. Somehow, though, the first 3 years of marriage, I married him when I was 18. He was 22. I had just graduated high school. He had just graduated college. He was working nights trying to pay the bills. I was trying to go to school during the day, taking a ton of hours to get through as fast as I could. And we barely saw each other. It was the three hardest years of our marriage. Besides that, he's Church of Christ. I'm Methodist. We're button heads. Where are we going to go to church? I'm more stubborn than he is. We kept going to my church. But we wasn't happy. We knew that was not where we were supposed to be. That was just where we were resting at the moment. So we were lukewarm. At best, we were lukewarm. But we were moving on with life. And life moved on. We built a house. I graduated. He got a day job. I was getting established as a teacher. He was well established in his job. We were doing everything just right. And about 6 years into our marriage, we decided it was time to have children. Everything was going just as planned. We got pregnant about a month after trying. And soon after that, complications arose. Complications so bad that after surgery, I ended up in Jackson General for 2 weeks, followed by a week at Vanderbilt with pneumonia and abscesses all around my female organs. Needless to say, that made any hope of ever becoming parents difficult. So we spent the next 3 years. Now, keep in mind, I struggled with my salvation for 3 years. We spent the next 3 years trying to conceive. And while I was in the hospital, I forgot who said it, you, I was mad. I was so mad at God. I easily could have died in that hospital, and there's a whole lot of God involved in what kept me out of the ICU, but that I'm not going to get into. But everybody around me was praying, but I didn't pray for myself. I was so mad. You know, I had done it right. I had, you know, by worldly standards, I had done everything I was supposed to do, and then this didn't work. And there was nothing I could do. I couldn't fix it. We could not fix infertility. We just couldn't do it. And so when there's nowhere else to go, where do we often go? We go to God. And I know it's a God thing, but we were sent a pastor that was way too good for our little Liberty Methodist church with 30 people. We were sent a guy that was straight out of college. He was on fire. He was fresh. And he and his wife were struggling with infertility. Every sermon he preached were to us. And, you know, we had to get to a point, and I remember the day I walked the aisle and gave it all to God, and I finally had to get to a point where it was okay if we didn't have kids. If that was not God's plan for me, it's what I wanted, but if God's plan was for us not to have children, if that meant I was supposed to adopt a baby from my classroom, because I was a kindergarten teacher at the time, if we were supposed to be foster parents, if we were supposed to go to Africa, I don't know. I didn't know what God's plan was, but I said, here I am. Here I am. I have faith. I know you've got this. A few months later, on July 4th, on Independence Day, I took a pregnancy test. It was an early pregnancy test. I wasn't supposed to, it wasn't supposed to have done anything. But it was positive, which makes a whole lot of sense since that was Will and Presley and they were twins. And so we were that just overjoyed to know that we were going to have, that we're going to be parents, that we were going to get to be parents. And we had always wanted three children, but once they arrived, we realized that they were a whole lot more of a handful than we had realized, especially the one with the mohawk. He was a huge handful as a baby. I'm talking major handful. And we were so blessed that we were so thankful. Why would we ever ask for a third? But you've always heard that story, you know, be careful what you pray for. Well, when they were 18 months old and throwing food on the floor and just about to drive us crazy, and a week after I had sold every item, every baby item I'd had at a consignment sale, I found out that this one was on the way, and boy, was I mad at him, because that was his fault. And so I pretty much worried the whole pregnancy that she was going to act like him, but she didn't. And she was like the perfect baby, and we drug her everywhere, and she completed our family. And it's just been a huge blessing. But I say all that to say, because I've gotten really off track, but we were still at Liberty Methodist Church with three babies, and they were the only babies now. Okay, and the church was growing even smaller. We knew we had to get out. And so we started visiting other churches, and I did not enjoy that. That is not fun. It's not fun trying to find your home. But we landed at Cornerstone in Scottsdale for a little bit, because like Union, Cornerstone is very welcoming, very loving. The second Sunday that I was there, they put me in children's church. And I felt that I was being used there, and we stayed. But our beliefs did not align. I don't want to get into it too much. But we decided we still needed, we stayed there for about a year. But while I was there, I feel like I grew leaps and bounds spiritually. I learned, you know, how much I need to praise and worship my Savior for everything He has given me. And I'm going long, so I'm fixing to finish. But we eventually made our way here. And I didn't even know this church existed. I'm sorry, guys. I mean, I live down the road. I didn't even know it was here. Clay said, why don't we try Union Baptist? I was like, okay. And the first Sunday we were here, Brother Chris was not even here. I think Ryan, what's the guy? He was the youth minister at First Baptist. Anyway, he did the sermon. I can't even remember really what he preached on, but he preached on something that basically told me this is where we needed to be. And we stayed. And it wasn't long, I guess about a year after being here, that I really fell under conviction to join the church. Because you guys know you don't let people get involved very much and do a whole lot if you're not a member. And I really wanted to be involved. So that's what we did. We were going to join the church, and I debated about telling this part, but I remember coming up here and telling Brother Chris, and I'd heard him announce this for so many other people, you know, oh, they're joining the church. But when he presented me and Clay that Sunday, he said, they want to join the church, and we have some stuff to talk about. And it hurt. It hurt a lot. Because, not at that moment, but that's where the devil really got a hold of me, because when I left, there was a big part of me that said, they don't want you there. It wasn't me. I mean, I know it was the devil. They don't want you there. You didn't get the same type of reaction everybody else got. But it was all very earthly, human things. It wasn't of God. But luckily, we stayed. We later talked to Brother Chris, and he said, you know, we would love to have you, but because of your background, you were baptized in a Methodist church. Clay was saved and baptized in Church of Christ. We need you to be rebaptized. And looking back, I think it was a lot of pride, but in my brain, I'd always been taught baptism is what comes after salvation. It's not you get baptized to join the church. And we didn't want to do anything that wasn't biblical. But I also know there's people that go to the Holy Lands and they get baptized again just because they want to be baptized in that water. And so we sat on it for a while. And Brother Chris said, he's like, Dana, you can still do everything. You just can't be a Sunday school teacher. I was like, okay, I can live with that. I don't have to be a Sunday school teacher. And COVID hit. 3 years passed. And Brother Anthony arrived. And it just wasn't going away. We knew we had to join. We knew we were supposed to be a part of Union Baptist Church, and so we stepped out in obedience, we were rebaptized, and we became members. And I think that was there's a little over a year ago, guys, a little over a year ago. And I don't know if you're aware of what's all happened in the past year since we stepped out in obedience, but all three of our children are saved. I am in a Bible study group with several ladies that I have prayed for my whole entire life. My husband is in a discipleship group, and I love you, baby, but I never saw that happening ever. God's just really showed out, and he's given me my heart's desire. And I'm just so thankful for this church. And I didn't say it the other day during homecoming because I knew Brother Greg had already asked me to say this, and I've gone long. But I'm just thankful for all of you, and I'm thankful for this church. And thank you, Jesus.
Greg, can I say something?
You sure can.
I'm thankful for this church. For the Lord, first of all, but the ones that work with the kids, Chelsea and Kristen and Dana, I watch, and the kids light up when y'all, you know, grab a hold of them and say something to them, and I'm so proud that they have took that on, because somebody's got to work with the kids. And of course, I'm proud of all the teachers that we have for everything else. I'm thankful for you and for Andy, all the music. This church is so blessed to have the talent, the want to, and the faith that we all have together as a family. And I just want to say that because I appreciate y'all so much.
Anybody else? I think we could all stand here for the rest of our lives thinking about how great he is. I think it would be fitting. Why don't we stand? And I want us to sing hymn number 147 about how good and how great our God is. How great thou art. Come to you at the close of this service saying that we are thankful for your greatness, your majesty, your awesome power. Thank you so much for these testimonies, Lord, for the lives that have been changed as a result of them being obedient to your will and your command. I pray, Lord, that each one of us that have heard these testimonies would be challenged in ourselves. Lord, that whatever we might face this week, whatever may come our way, all we have to do is listen to your spirit, your guidance, your direction. And Lord, that great things will be accomplished because we've been faithful to you. God, go with us now. Be with all of our church family that's not with us. We give you thanks, praise, honor, and love. And we ask these things in your Son's precious name. Amen. God bless you. Have a good week.